on more boards than I can name. She's a founding member of International Funders for Indigenous Peoples. She has a regular column on Indian Country Today. She's founder and president of First Peoples Worldwide. She's a delegate to the United Nations for Indigenous Rights. She's awarded a doctorate in humane letters from Dartmouth. She's chosen as one of America's most influential women by PBS's Women Who Make America. Co-author of The Color of Wealth. And I could go on and on and on. It's my honor to introduce Rebecca Adams.
Hi. I want to thank everyone for the opportunity to be here today. In particular, I want to just flat out admit, I was excited for an entire year to come to this conference. And I had planned to be here from the very beginning and just absorb all of this incredible wisdom and this generosity of spirit and this just real deep insights. At the same time, I think I know you're probably all aware of the Dakota Access Pipeline. And I have to say that our office has gotten caught up in trying to help respond to what's happening out in North Dakota right now. So I trained in last night, got here this morning, and I was sitting here thinking about how much I had wanted to be here all along. But I have to thank you for just today replenishing every cell in my body with just the thoughts and the ideas and the insights that you've been sharing. I work in a separate of sort of the indigenous work up here. I work with what's called the socially responsible investment movement that had many, many names. It became socially responsible investing, then it became social investing, then it became sustainable investing, then it became responsible investing, then it became ESG investing. ESG investing stands for environment, social, and governance. And so we work with a body of investors that really look at companies' behavior in the areas of environment, social, and governance before they make an investment decision. Sometimes if they're already in a company that isn't upholding the standards, they'll enter a dialogue with that company. And as a last resort, they'll divest. So we have been into a deep, deep investment organizing process over the past several weeks. And in fact, I have to sort of apologize because right after this meeting, I have to go into a conference call with a key investor in the Dakota Access Pipeline. And we're going to be sharing with them the materiality of risk in that S component of ESG investing. But I'm going to be back tonight, and I'm going to be here all day tomorrow. So I'm just truly, truly looking forward to it. It might not be exactly the way I thought it was going to be, and I was going to be here the whole time. But I can feel a tremendous healing coming out of it, because it hurts in North Dakota. And I think the prayers and the ideas and the gifts that you're bringing, I know are traveling to North Dakota. I'd like to share the phone number of the governor of North Dakota later on today and encourage you all to personally give him a call. The last live stream I saw before I came up here was we've got 19 more warriors arrested. We've got the National Guard in complete riot with assault rifles moving in. We know we're going to win, but let's win without getting anybody hurt in this, and so I'd love to share that phone number. I think the governor wants to hear from you all, and so I would encourage that. I have a t-shirt on. I'm going to do a little commercial break on the t-shirt. It basically summarizes what I want to talk about today. My t-shirt says, Indigenous economics is the science of production, distribution, and consumption according to millennial principles of balance and harmony. So that there's a way for our economic system to respect all living things and to provide prosperity for all. In fact, that's basically what Indigenous economies have been doing. I want to start with a sort of a quote that my grandmother used to say, or my mother too. Actually, it passed on and on. I think in some ways it was probably our sort of form of parenting, and it probably says more about me than anything else. But during my teenage years, when I was testing every single boundary, whether I saw it or not, Mom would set me down and she'd go, "Rebecca Lee, if you don't change directions, you're going to end up where you're headed." Well, okay. I think that serves a fundamental mantra for today. We have to change directions because we all know where we're headed. And there's nothing truer than what Mama says. And if we don't change directions, we are going to end up where we all don't want to be. So today I wanted to talk about that. I wanted to talk about what's going on in Dakota is a fight for the water beings. So much of what we talked about today was an understanding of the living, breathing, sensate beings that are all around us. Most of the Plains Indians, most all of us actually recognize there's life in water, and water is life. Those water beings need protected, and yet there's no cost measurement out there to give us the value of the water beings. So I'm going to talk about that because I really think the four areas I kind of want to cover is I really think how we see the world determines how we act. So we need to talk about that, and this has been a great forum for that. So I thank you. I've been learning a lot, and I've been feeling so much better than when I got here this morning. I want to talk about the beliefs and the values behind the economic system, and in particular, the indigenous economic system. And I want to talk about how indigenous economies are organized. And then I want to give you probably what I hope is going to be a rather shocking modern day contemporary application of indigenous economics. First, I'll tell you a little bit about my organization. I'm with First Peoples Worldwide. We make small grants around the world. We're about 62 countries. Grants are between $500 to $10,000, a big grant would be a $20,000 grant. We also do corporate engagement, which is what I already started talking about. This is where we've got our grants. Like I said, we're working with extremely traditional grassroots communities. One third of the grants that we have made have gone to communities that have never, ever had funding before. So I'm very proud of that, because to do a kind of direct grassroots outreach from an international organization outside of Washington, D.C., is a powerful statement to the network and the vibrant linkage between indigenous peoples. And our approach is pretty straightforward. The kinds of things we fund, we basically are looking at development with people. It's not a two people, and it's not four people. Development is really with people. And so with that kind of guidance, what we're seeing is real indigenous modern day models are coming out of this grant making. We also start looking at the untapped resources, and traditional knowledge is a classic. Traditional ecological knowledge is a classical untapped resource that might be mobilized. And then we look at the indigenous economy as to how it operates within itself and with the neighboring economies, and it's embedded within a greater economy. And then we look at successful development, increasing economic productivity with diverse revenue streams. We don't see it as one silver bullet, you know, bring in a plant and everybody has a job. This is basically the approach we use. Now, when I talk about indigenous peoples' tie to the land and the profound worldview that I'm going to get to in a minute, I want to give a slide that shows you globally what's at risk here. Indigenous people around the world, if you were to total up our land base, it's about 20% of the Earth's land surface. So that means 80% of the rest of the planet is non-indigenous lands. Now, on that 20% of the Earth's surface lives 80% of the remaining biodiversity in this world. 80% of all life is on indigenous lands. That is not a coincidence. That is not because we don't have the technology to destroy it. It is simply we have the genius to steward it and the brilliance for how to do that. The indigenous understanding has its basis of spirituality in a recognition of the interconnectedness and the interdependence of all living things, a holistic and balanced view of the world. All things are bound together. All things connect. What happens to the earth happens to the children of the earth. We've not woven the web of life. We're just one thread of it. Whatever we do to the web, we do to ourselves. The environment is perceived as a sensate, conscious entity, suffused with spiritual powers through which the human understanding is only realized in perfect humility before the sacred whole. The Hopi expressed this concept of being in perfect harmony and balance with the laws of the universe as Navoite. The Tlingit refer to it as Shabon. There's no word in the English language. Modern science is just now beginning to catch up with such ancient wisdom. Clearly, Bell's theorem on quantum physics, Einstein's theory of relativity, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, all indicate how and when we look at subatomic particles affects what we see. All particles of matter, property, position, velocity, are affected by intention or presence of all other particles. Stated in simpler terms, atoms are aware of other atoms. According to this law of nature, a people rooted in land over time have exchanged their tears, their breath, their bones, all their elements, oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, hydrogen, phosphorus, sulfur, all the rest with their habitat many, many, many times over. In the words of Dene traditionalist Ruth Benali Nishi, our history cannot be told without naming the cliffs and mountains that have witnessed our people. Here, nature knows us. The closest contemporary philosophy comes to understanding earthbound spirituality is the concept of Gaia. However, tribal people worship the sacredness of creation as a way of life, not as a philosophy or religion. In fact, none of the native languages have words or terms synonymous with religion. The closest expression of belief literally translates to the way we live. In 1986, the World Wildlife Fund convened Buddhists, Hindus, Judaists, Christians, and Muslims in the Umbria Hills of Italy to issue their collective ecological wisdom, the Assisi Declarations. The intent was to provide a universal backdrop for aligning human nature to a greater good and stewardship of creation. In the end, the declarations could only document what had already been an intuitive finding. The way we live, within a consciousness responsible for the sacred whole, was not a central practice of any of the other great religions or teachings. Yet human consciousness determines what we do and how we do it. Consciousness is given order through a belief system. The reality of any belief system is expressed through ideas. The ideas are realized through values. Values permeate human life. They give us practical guidance. Moreover, values do not work alone. Ideas such as love, truth, and justice work according to values of caring, honesty, and fairness. The wise to be wise must also be just. Every society organizes itself politically, socially, and economically according to its values. In spiritual terms, this is evolution. In human terms, this is development. And in this issue of development, more than any other issue, is the battle line between two competing worldviews. The Euro-American values of individualism, domination, exploitation, and separation, versus the tribal values of kinship, balance, reciprocity, and interconnectedness. Western economists like to think of economics as value neutral, a system operating separate from its surrounding environment, which in and of itself denies the totality of the whole. It denies the sacred. Based upon their belief system, economists assume a scarcity of resources and individual insatiable appetites. We're a bunch of individuals out there, an aggregate of us, with insatiable appetites. Well, of course we're going to run out of resources if that's truly what you believe. And you cannot take an economics 101 course without being taught the laws of economics are individual insatiable appetites, that's homo economists, and scarcity of resources. In other words, unlimited desires competing for limited resources. Subsequently, the values to be realized are competition, materialism, acquisition, accumulation, ownership, growth, and immediacy. For Native people, the whole, not merely a part of it, establishes a dynamic system of being, which gives rise to an order of things. Native spirituality assumes the whole manifests an order that unifies physical, conscious, moral, and spiritual life. The tribal belief system assumes a prosperity and abundance of creation. It also fundamentally assumes a kinship-based sense of enoughness. That because we are so connected, because we care so much for each other and all living things, there's an abundance, and we know when there's enoughness. I've seen this in operation time and time again. Being in Alaska, camping out and cooking, someone gets a beaver. A young kid might get up and think he's gonna shoot the mate, and everybody in camp's gonna be going, no, no, we have enough. Based upon this profound worldview, a complex reciprocal belief system, what are the real values behind Native societies and how do they organize economically? The values there are prosperity is achievable within the limits of creation. The affirming value system introduces harmony, prudence, reciprocity, distribution, kinship, sustainability, and caring for the future generations. That's why 80% of the remaining biodiversity is on our lands. This, again, is not a coincidence. It's not about technology. It's about how you look at the world. Tribal people's fundamental value was sustainability, and they conducted their livelihoods in ways that sustained resources and limited inequalities in their society. What made traditional economies so radically different and so very, very fundamentally dangerous to Western economies were the traditional principles of sustainability versus growth. You cannot have sustainable growth. You can only have sustainability or you can have growth. So we've got to get over this myth of growth. And capitalism can cry till the night comes down and the sun comes back. We've got to deal with the issue of sustainability versus growth. We know this. 45,000 years of living in harmony and balance, we know the goal is sustainability, because that's survival. Traditional principles of sustainability versus growth, abundance versus scarcity of resources, sharing and distribution versus accumulation and exploitation, and a sense of kinship usage rights versus individual exclusive ownership rights. Indigenous societies which have not been disrupted value stability and sustainability instead of growth. They protect resources in many ways, including the promotion of anti-consumerist ethics. Juxtapose these values against the fundamental values of an individualistic society in this country of accumulation and growth, and you can see why there's been a conflict. Nowhere can the war waged against native sustainable economies be better seen than what is taking place under the guise of today's globalized economy. Many non-natives assume an indigenous economy is a series of subsistence activities such as hunting, fishing, and foraging. To the native, the subsistence economy embodies their entire way of life. It is the way to be a land-linked tribal people. It links the generation and the extended family through traditional law, legends, and ceremonies, all tied to a concern for the land, water, resources, and creation. It is a spiritual and communal way of life. The indigenous economy, more than any other issue, is the battle line between two competing worldviews: the Euro-American values of individualism, equal opportunity, private property, and accumulation, versus the tribal values of kinship, communal usage, sharing, cultural identity, and spirituality. The cultural socio-economic system of an indigenous economy operates on a very different rule set than the Western model. There are four germane characteristics. First is, community is understood to be essential for survival. Everyone owns it, but no one can sell it. Place and locality are regarded as the foundation whereby community control of capital in all its forms is accepted as a necessary precondition to sustainability. Individual liberty and community are balanced, as rights are balanced by responsibilities. Equity and justice within and between communities have been recognized as central to a sustainable society. Cooperation rather than competition has been accepted as a key to sustainability. The locations of all of our traditional hunting and fishing activities and camps are influenced by a system of non-codified customary law that defines right of access. This is resource allocations. Trap lines, fish camps, net sites, big game areas are recognized as used by particular kinship groups. The mere fact you were born into a clan gave you economic rights. Codified or not, the system of land use represents a socio-political organization of regulating access and resources and communal use over these resources. The second characteristic is that nature is understood to be a source of knowledge, a model to emulate, and a mentor to learn by. Subsistence follows a seasonal nature of harvesting. Resources are taken when they're available and best, and when they are needed. Harvests are governed above all by the principle that one does not waste, but takes only what is needed. Seasons were not set by arbitrary dates, but when game was available and when the quality of that particular fish or game was considered the best. This is a stark contrast between the Western model of maximum yield. The third principle component of subsistence or an indigenous economy is the interplay of spiritual beliefs with harvesting and production. Complex systems of beliefs, knowledge, and values associated with wild resource, natural resource uses pass between generations as the cultural and oral traditions of a social group. These beliefs define the relationship between hunter and prey and those within the community itself. In the native manner, fish and wildlife are co-equal partners in an interconnected ecosystem. One does not catch the fish, the fish offers itself to the fisherman. A sports fisher's tendency to catch and release fish is viewed as disrespectful and harmful to future catches. Humility, restraint, and understanding that there are limits guide our actions as befits good stewards. So that the fourth cultural component of subsistence economies is that it derives its meaning from the context of the group. The ways in which harvest and processing activities are divided up within the community, the critical customs of sharing, barter, and customary trade embody all of the dynamics of an economic system. The primary economic production unit or firm is flexible kinship configurations that change and shift based on the resources to be taken and the expertise needed in the process. I'm going to say that again because I'm going to come back to that point, but that the primary economic production unit or firm is flexible kinship configuration that changes and shifts based upon the resources to be taken and the expertise needed to harvest and process it. Small groups, families, and extended families determine the production units and also serve as the basis for distribution. Sharing and trading throughout inner and inter-community commerce pattern. Sharing and trading flow throughout inner and inter-community commerce patterns. The system is not market-based, but rather extensive intra-community and inter-community trade and exchange networks. Based upon reciprocity, those who receive are expected to give something to someone else. The value is in sharing, and you can go to many Indigenous communities today and you will see rituals and ceremonies that are expressions of sharing, because a people's prestige and influence within the community is based largely upon their generosity and upon not upon their personal wealth. Well, these are values that hold forth today. I showed you earlier sort of the globe of where we've been making grants. I want to talk about several of our grants in this, because these are contemporary. These are the grants where we don't have a focus. You don't have to come in and have a particular project. In fact, we're asking Indigenous people to come in with their ideas. What we want to see is Indigenous development so that we can begin to trace the values through this. The first project we got looks at how there's an understanding of principle that in the Indigenous worldview, we are all related as individuals, as part of a kinship-based community, and as part of nature and in balance with it. This is the Samburu. I have a Subaru. This is the Samburu Advocacy and Human Security Project. They're one of Kenya's seven Indigenous peoples. They've raised and herded cattle since the 15th century, and they're under tremendous violent pressure by the Kenyan government to become sedentary and move into permanent village sites. To the Samburu, the livestock are much more than a form of wealth. They're a source of subsistence, for sure, but they constitute the cement of social relations and a focal point of ritual acts. Facing imminent eviction, our grant went to the Samburu to network from people to people, to clan to clan, to community to community. The Samburu networked to bring international attention to their land rights. And we're happy to say they've brought the attention. They haven't secured a title, but they've brought the attention and they've slowed down the Kenyan government's desire to remove them from territories they've been living in since the 15th century. The other one I talked about was nature is essential for survival. This is the foundation of sustainable development of the Altai in Russia. Land has breath. This is a song they sing in their language, translated. And they believe what's happening right now, this is what we made the grant for, was that the energy of Mother Earth is weakening, and that this is a song that brings back the power to Mother Earth. This is a song that carries through our being and is tamped into Mother Earth as they sing and dance. Land has breath. an umbilical cord, nose, mouth, eyes, and ears. Everything that exists on earth is alive. That's the song they sing. Altai is a harmonious coexistence of humanity and nature. This is the traditional wisdom of the people of the Russia Republic, located at the crossroads of China, Kazakhstan, and Mongolia. What we funded was local leaders, elders, shamans, and local herders and hunters to share their observation on climate change and to tie it with their traditional ceremonies to begin to give back that energy of life and flow to Mother Earth, because they know nature is essential for survival. This is the Lu people in Kenya. It's a woman's project. And here they're seeing that they were actually struggling. There was a myriad of difficulties in just food security. Malnutrition, dehydration, and brink of starvation. So our grant went to the women's group there to begin a co-op. And it was fascinating because they were seen as working with nature, and they were seeing this abundance come alive again before their very eyes, a belief that they had had, a language that has no ability to express scarcity, was on the brink of starvation, with a belief system that saw prosperity in creation, and fully believed that the reason they were facing what they were facing was because they had failed to do their duty in taking care of Mother Earth. This is in Uganda again, and this is how production and protection go together. What was happening in Uganda was that the plastic bags became a huge packaging problem. And in fact, all the packaging of any kind of material that was brought into the community was wrapped in plastic. And so pretty soon it was ruining and destroying the environment. So they put together a volunteer program, and there was 30 young girls that had dropped out of school. And they were trained in environmental stewardship with both traditional ecological knowledge and with some of the Western techniques. And again, they began to develop carrying and packaging materials made out of the local plants. They wove the weaving to wrap things. They took the weavings and made satchels. Everything that they made by way of container and packaging came out of the natural plant materials, because protection and production go together. Here we've seen the indigenous economies are independent, interdependent, and promote responsible resource management, sustainability, and have a sense of enoughness. This is in Quechua, in the Peruvian highlands, and the women up there have an incredible calcancanca type of weaving. And it was about ready to die out. So basically what we did was we made through a grant the project where they could begin teaching in the different within their community, and then within the next door community, and then within the next door community. And then once they had their intra-community network on the weavings together, they entered into the market. And it's really a marketing arm now for the Quechuan weavings. Of how they were able to enter into the marketplace. By being interdependent among themselves, they can produce the volume they need, they can provide the quality that the consumer wants, and they can bring an income into their communities. The other thing we saw that came out of an indigenous economy and a direct application was in a permacultural project in El Salvador. And here, what we saw was a number of environmental needs, and looking at how to meet both the community needs within this environmental stewardship. And so they really put in, they joined together. It was sort of a, in development terms, you might call it a sweat equity project, where solar panels were provided, but it was the village working together in different self-help units that put in place throughout the village and throughout three other neighboring villages the solar panels they needed to have the kinds of energy resources they wanted. In all cases, what was fascinating about these projects was that the basic underlying goal, in, no matter whether it was weaving packaging material, putting up solar panels, growing foods and gardening. The goal was always to meet the most needs for the most people. Always, all these economic activities, the goal was to meet the most needs for the most people possible. That's pretty much in stark contrast to what we have in our economy today. Subsistence, in actual fact, is a complex economic system with axes formed by interdependence and sharing. It requires the organized labor of nearly every man, woman, and child. It operates according to a complex network of associations, rights, and obligations. The six characteristics of a subsistence or indigenous economy: it's a mixed economy composed of mutually supportive market and subsistence sectors, the domestic mode of production where capital, land, and labor are controlled by kinship-based production units, an established seasonal round of production activities, networks of sharing, distribution, and exchange of food and materials, networks operating all the time, and I'm going to talk about the networks for a little bit, traditional systems of land use and occupancy, and a complex system of beliefs, knowledge, and values all associated with natural resource uses. These are all passed on through generation upon generation. What I want to do is take these traditional principles, 10, 20, 30,000 year old economic principles, and I want to apply it in one last story. But I want to tell you what the moral of the story is before I tell you the story. The moral is that it's not just an indigenous thing. This is not just an Indian thing. Values of cooperation, reciprocity, equity, egalitarian, equal relationships, communal ownership, and distribution are sustainable. Values of competition, accumulation, exploitation, and growth are not. The story starts in 1968. The entire industry was on the verge of collapse. This industry was losing more than $1 million a day, which was a high figure back in 1968. It was characterized by a dominance of a few major proprietary players, a strangling web of competition and licensing arrangements, and intensely competing interests. This was an industry in the 1960s and throughout the beginning of the 70s that could not sustain itself. It was only because of sheer desperation for survival that led it to create a radically new sort of organization, one that at its heart has a set of principles that parallel an indigenous economy. The values for organizing this new entity were: community is essential, the entity can be owned but it cannot be bought and sold, all ownership and financing must be equitable, equity and justice within and among every member of this sector was essential. No one player could have an advantage over any of the other players. Equity was essential. There could be no intrinsic advantage among any of the members. Cooperation was key. No members or groups of members can dominate the discussion or the decisions. The production units were flexible networks that changed and shifted. Members were simultaneously owners, customers, peers, superiors, and subordinates, depending on the task that was to be undertaken. Small groups, networks, and extended networks operate and grow, replicating without any centralized control. The structure itself is infinitely malleable and adaptable, but the organization itself is extremely durable with regards to the principles and the purpose. Does anybody know what this is?
I'm just trying to guess, but I can't go.
Visa, credit card industry. Every bank, there was no way they could get the banks to operate together. There was no, I don't know if any of you are old enough to remember, but every bank used to have its own credit card. And every bank was competing with another bank and its credit card. So in order for them to get a distribution of credit, now they were not distributing wealth, do not get me wrong. They were not sharing the wealth at all, but they had to come to terms with how to get this credit distributed, and they used the exact system of a subsistence or indigenous economy. This is a map of a whale harvest. This is a map that shows all the places that the whale is distributed. You can literally not count the number of points that that whale meat gets distributed. Here's one, same village, it's an Inupiat village up in Alaska, and this is cash. This is cash going into that very same village and the distribution of the cash.
Can you go back and forth?
That's, I'm sorry?
Can you go back? Oh, you did, okay.
Yeah. Same village, it's an Inupiat village in Alaska. Following the principles of an indigenous economy, flexible units of production, consumption, distribution, subordinates are superiors, decentralized. This is a brilliant, brilliant system of distribution. This is what we operate under today. The fact is that successful tribal development contradicts most of today's economic assumptions. The profound vision within indigenous economies reaches well beyond Indian country. Given the opportunity and resources to explore development and develop our own answers, Native people will create unique, culturally relevant, and sustainable economies. Sustainable economic systems for themselves, for their family, community, and for the tribe, and it will be in balance and harmony with the sacred whole. Spirituality affects everything. It is the most difficult to describe and even harder to measure. However, such values-based development will provide lessons on how those outside the tribal community may reorganize our future, making spirituality central to all elements of our lives, both in work and personally. Both Western and Indigenous cultures can benefit from accessing and sharing beliefs, customs, and technologies. Such interactions of forces and cultures create a new dynamic which fosters creativity and progress. But Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist William Raspberry in the Washington Post editorial, it was titled The Power of Spirituality. He reported on a community leader who came to the realization that successful programs almost always have a spiritual base. But it doesn't get mentioned in the surveys and evaluations and requests for funding. There are no blank forms on spirituality. No blanks on the form for spirituality. We don't yet have scales to weigh the ability of some people that some people have to provide the spiritual element. But at this point in time, we must recognize that we do all have to protect the water beings. We have to protect the water beings. For tribal people who see the world as a whole, the essence of our work is in its entirety. In a society where all are related, where everybody is someone else's mother, father, brother, sister, aunt, or cousin, and where you cannot leave without eventually coming home, simple decisions require the approval of nearly everyone in that society. It is the society as a whole and not merely a part of it that must survive. This is the indigenous understanding. It is the understanding we need in a global sense. Thank you. questions?
I know somebody's got some questions. I have one just to start with.
Sure.
I want to get back to the visa. Well, I hope somebody does, but you had indicated that one of the premises for grants that you give is about ideas. Yeah, could you kind of give a specific what you mean if Indigenous people come to you to get a grant with an idea? How does that work?
We worked hard on our grant making process because we want to reach traditionalists, and we recognize that traditional people aren't necessarily going to think in a linear Western. Give us your measurable objectives, So we start with the question of tell us your story. And then we ask, what are your values and particular beliefs that will make you successful in what you want to do? And then now tell us what you want to do. And so we set it up so that it's not linear, but it's a storytelling thing. And then we take applications sometimes by Skype, poor errors. We've had, in fact, some of the stories, like we did a grant in the Philippines. And when the elders came in to give their grant report, so we'll just have the grant report on Skype, we have an interpreter, and then we take the notes, and they tell us what they've been doing. In one case, they told us about this company called Extrada that had come into their territories and was mining, and they did not want the company there because they hadn't said the report to come. And then they told us how, when the warriors spoke out about it, two of the warriors had their families brutally assassinated. And they were now hiding out. So that's where we have this ability to reach into communities and find out what's really going on. We have the ability within 24 hours, we had the investors of that company on the phone, and within 48 hours, we had the company on the phone. And then Extrada got bought by Glencore. But I mean, in telling that story, let me also introduce a colleague and a very, very dear friend of mine, John Guffey. Did you leave? Oh, I have the founder of the Calvert Social Investment Funds with me today. He's one of the guys in the late 1970s that designed the whole environmental social governance components of the ESGs, whatever you want to call it. I mean, it's changed so many names, it doesn't even matter. But of that, and so what we've been doing is building this investment community that begins to look at this kind of damage as material risk. And so what we've done, like in the Dakota Pipeline now, is we're beginning to quantify material risk around social so that when a mining site gets shut down, it costs between $20 and $30 million a week for that company. This starts to become material risk for investors. So that's how we've been going at this. We've been documenting the material risks when these corporations come in and do this. So a lot of the grant making, I shouldn't say a lot, we don't require it to be attached to a corporate activity. We just want the ideas to come in. So we get probably about 700 proposals a year or requests for a Skype to have a discussion about it. And we only give away like $200,000 a year. So it's allowed us to have a direct grassroots community reach. I wanted to point him out so you guys could grab him. Well, he must have known that.
I'm going to be leaving after the talking session.
I'm
going to be leaving after the talking session today, so I wanted to just mention and make an offer. I publish opednews.com. It reaches a couple hundred thousand unique people a year. We try to help activists and support them. So, for example, if you told your grantees that they would have a voice with us, we would publish their work. We publish from all over the world. If you're a speaker here, I would love to make you a trusted author, which means that you would be able to post articles directly and it would go live immediately to the site. I hope I haven't broken any rules here, but we did win a human rights award from the whistleblowers for our support of whistleblowers, and would love to enable you to get voices out, because my impression is there's not enough. For example, on the Dakota Pipeline, we've had articles every day for the last couple weeks, including people there on the site. So get in touch with me. It's rob@opednews.com if you want to.
Could I have your card?
I don't have a card with me.
Nobody
seems to have cards here.
I have to apologize. We've got a call with an investor at 3. Now I understand where he went. We have an investor on the line that's in the Dakota Access Pipeline right now that we're meeting. We've got a at 3. And I'm going to be around through tomorrow, too, so why don't you guys just grab me if you have any questions. I'm sorry I have to leave now. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.